Hey guys, it's James here. A couple of months ago, I bought one of Apple's new M2 MacBook Air laptops to test how well it holds up as the primary computer in my professional studio, and how it compares to my much more expensive M1 Max MacBook Pro for music production. The M2 MacBook Air I bought is the base model because I wanted to see what the cheapest one can do. It has the M2 chip with 8 cores, 4 of them performance and 4 of them efficiency, 256GB of SSD storage, and 8GB of RAM. My M1 Max MacBook Pro, in comparison, has 10 cores, 8 of them performance and 2 of them efficiency, 4TB of SSD storage, and 64GB of RAM. I didn't mention GPU because GPU power doesn't make a big enough difference in a music production context as of today. If you're interested, I actually have a review video for my 16-inch M1 Max MacBook Pro and an ultimate M1 Mac buying guide video, specifically for music production, over here and in the links in the description. After using the M2 MacBook Air for about 2 months as the main computer in my studio, I will have to say that I'm super impressed by the sheer power this little laptop can produce without any active cooling system. I mean, this computer can run all the big mixing and mastering projects I did on my M1 Max MacBook Pro no problem, with actually extra power to spare. I'll show you the actual comparisons later in the video, but a short version is that the M2 MacBook Air is no joke. Plugin compatibility is no longer an issue now, since most plugin companies have released plugins with native support for Apple Silicon. And for the few that haven't, Rosetta 2 worked just fine in my experience. Although those companies really need to hurry up. If you want to know how to make x86 plugins work on your M2 machine, check out my M1 Max MacBook Pro review video. I have detailed instructions there. I want to briefly talk about the hardware first. The M2 MacBook Air is unbelievably light and thin. When I hold it in my hand, it almost feels like I'm holding an iPad. In comparison, my 16-inch MacBook Pro is way heavier and bulkier. As someone who carries the laptop around in a backpack often, the 16-inch MacBook Pro really adds a lot to the load. Just take a look at how big of a difference they have. I struggled to hold the 16-inch MacBook Pro in one hand while I was filming this, and holding the MacBook Air felt like nothing in comparison. So the M2 MacBook Air is definitely an extremely travel-friendly laptop. Connectivity options are quite limited, however, as it only gives you 2 Thunderbolt ports and a headphone jack. If you have lots of things to connect, you're going to need to invest in a couple of USB hubs. Thankfully, you can charge the laptop via the MagSafe port, so it's not taking up a Thunderbolt port at least. Now let's move on to the testing. Keep in mind, I'm not a professional tech reviewer, so the tests are not going to be super comprehensive or scientific, but they should give you an idea of what you can expect in practice. And unlike my M1 Max MacBook Pro video, this time I'm focusing on testing ARM plugins simply because most plugin companies now have, like I said, native Apple Silicon support. First, let's compare multi-core performance with some amp sims. I put Overloud's THU on a stereo guitar DI track and duplicate the track as many times as possible until I get a system overload message when I play all the tracks at the same time. In Logic Pro X, the M1 Max MacBook Pro was able to handle 295 tracks of THU playing simultaneously at 16 times oversampling, while the M2 MacBook Air reached its limit at 150 tracks, so about 97% less tracks compared to the M1 Max machine. When I did the same test with a different amp sim, STL Tones AmpHub, I was surprised to see that the M1 Max MacBook Pro could only handle 16 tracks and the M2 computer 11 tracks. It seems that STL AmpHub either requires way more CPU power or is much less optimized for the Apple Silicon system compared to Overloud's THU. Maybe it's both, I don't know. But the gap between the M1 Max and M2 computers still showed. Next, I replaced STL AmpHub with NeuroDSP's Archetype Gojira amp sim, which ran under Rosetta 2 because there's still no ARM version. And I did the same tests again. The M1 Max MacBook Pro was able to handle 55 tracks, while the M2 MacBook Air capped out at 25 tracks. I repeated this test in Rosetta Logic just to see if there would be any difference, and the results were the same. Next up, I ran those same tests in Reaper, which kind of serves as a token for non-Apple DAWs in this scenario, supposedly without Apple's hardware software optimization magic. The M1 Max MacBook Pro was able to run 326 tracks before the audio started to crackle, while the M2 MacBook Air reached its limit at 214 tracks. These results are quite interesting. With the M1 Max MacBook Pro, Reaper was able to offer a performance increase of 11% compared to Logic. With the M2 MacBook Air, the performance increase is about 43%. These are not negligible differences, especially the latter. Could it be that Reaper actually runs better on an Apple Silicon computer than Logic? To test this hypothesis, I swapped THU for STL to AmpHub, and I got similar results. The M1 Max MacBook Pro was able to handle 30 tracks in Reaper and the M2 MacBook Air 19 tracks. Respectively, these are performance increases of 86% and 72%. I decided to also test the hypothesis with the neural DSP Archetype Gojira, which had to run under Rosetta 2. This time, there was no performance difference between Reaper and Logic. It's hard to make any definitive conclusions based on just a few tests, so do with the information as you will. The next test I did was to benchmark the single core performance of the M2 MacBook Air and the M1 Max MacBook Pro. I put FabFilter's Saturn 2 on a stereo track where I created as many bands as possible, which is 6, used heavy saturation mode for each band, used the highest oversampling, and turned on linear phase. This makes each instance of Saturn to be very CPU intensive, and I tried to put as many instances of it as possible on one single track. The result from both computers were completely identical. They both max out at 9 instances of Saturn 2 on a single track. This means that the M2 chip and the M1 Max chip have the same single core performance, though the M2 chip is supposed to have a slightly faster single core speed compared to the M1 line chips. So I'm not sure why the test results were identical. Perhaps the difference isn't big enough to make a difference in this use case. Now let's move on to RAM. RAM is crucial for using sample libraries. I was curious to see how much of an advantage having 64 GB of RAM would be compared to only 8 GB of RAM. I also wanted to test how each computer handled memory swapping. When a system runs out of RAM, memory swapping will happen, which basically means that the system will start using your hard drive space as temporary RAM. Because normal HDDs and SSDs are much, much slower than RAM, when a lot of memory swapping happens, your system will become very laggy. I'm sure you have experienced this before. You have way too many Chrome tabs or applications open, and your computer becomes barely responsive. Both the M1 Max MacBook Pro and the M2 MacBook Air have insanely fast SSDs, which theoretically should allow you to use SSD storage like RAM via memory swapping without experiencing significant system slowdown. If that's the case, does that mean that musicians and producers who use a lot of sample libraries can save some money by getting less RAM on these new MacBooks without sacrificing performance? Well, turns out that's certainly too good to be true. For the M2 MacBook Air, which has 8GB of RAM, I put Super Hero Drummer 3 on a track and created a big kit that used 3.7GB worth of samples. I was able to duplicate it 10 times before Logic told me that an AU plugin isn't working and Logic had to quit. So a total of 11 instances of SD3. So in total, 41GB of samples were loaded, and the M2 laptop was able to handle 39GB of swap memory. In comparison, M1 Max MacBook Pro, which has 64GB of RAM, could handle 26 instances of SD3 with the same kit, totaling about 98GB of samples loaded, with 59GB in swap memory. I did the same tests in Reaper and got the same result. So while M2 can handle quite a bit of memory swapping is really only a clutch, and you should definitely get more RAM if you know you'll be using a lot of sample libraries. The next thing I tested was project loading speed. I have a large mixing and mastering project containing, I actually forgot to put it on my teleprompter, but the project contains this many tracks and 270 plugins and lots of complex routing. It took the M2 MacBook Air 1 minute and 14 seconds to load it. And surprisingly, it took the M1 Max 1 minute and 21 seconds to load the project, just a bit longer than the M2 laptop. It could be because some of the plugins on the M1 Max were an older version, since I installed them a while back, or it could be just margin of error. But either way, the difference wasn't huge. The last test I did was comparing the CPU consumption of the same project on each laptop. On the M2 MacBook Air, this project used about 54% of the CPU, and on the M1 Max MacBook Pro, it was about 36%. That's about a 50% difference, which isn't gargantuan, but the advantage of the M1 Max chip would start to show as the project gets bigger. The bottom line is the M2 MacBook Air was able to handle my mixing and mastering needs as a professional audio engineer with extra power to spare. If I didn't need the extra RAM, the GPU power, and extra connectivity options, the M2 MacBook Air could certainly replace the M1 Mac MacBook Pro for me in terms of CPU power. The M2 MacBook Air is truly a powerful computer, especially when you consider the fact that it has no active cooling system. Obviously, everyone's use case is different, but I think a lot of people in the music and recording industry, professionals or otherwise, will find the M2 MacBook Air more than sufficient for their musical needs. Given that it costs just $1,199 for the base model, which is the model I tested, it's probably the best laptop you can get for music production for in this price range. I can see this laptop to be absolutely perfect for touring musicians who need a highly portable laptop for backing tracks, or audio engineers who need to move around a lot and need their studio operation on a laptop, or music producer who want to work on music on the go. Just make sure you get the right amount of RAM and SSD storage. I did find that 256 GB of storage was definitely too little for me. After installing a whole bunch of professional apps, I only had half the space left. At the end of the day, only you can know how much SSD storage is right for you. That's it for the video. Give it a like if you find it helpful and informative. Subscribe if you want more music production content on my channel, and I'll see you next time.